In this Indian Tribe tour, we'll learn how network socket programming works in C on Linux. This episode discusses the server of the client-server pair and assumes that you have watched the earlier episode on client. If something doesn't make sense, go ahead and take a look at the client video. It's only 6 minutes and 40 seconds, link in the description. Let's write a simple server program that serves requests coming in on port 6969 and simply prints to console any message received. We make a file called server.c. I use Micro to edit it. We include some header files. To see why those files are needed, take a look at my source code, link in the description. First, we create the main function. We print a simple message for debugging. Let's define some inputs. Since we need to read messages from the socket, we will need a buffer. Let's make it 1000 bytes. Of course, in any non-trivial program, it's a good idea to reason about the actual size needed and do memory checks. But for now, let's YOLO and disregard all that. Port number is 6969. We need to specify how many connections can be pending on a listening port before the server starts rejecting additional incoming requests. For our purpose, I'm just going to say 1 here. We need an integer for the server socket handle. Recall from my video on the client that hints for get adder info must be in a struct adder info. So we create 1 and clean its memory. Also recall from the client video, we also need 2 other adder info structs here. Next, we configure the hint structure exactly the same as we did in the client program. We then call getAdderInfo to translate the address using the hints we provided. Note that unlike what we did in the client program, the first argument is set to null as we have no IP address, as this is the server program. We include some rudimentary exception handling debugging message here. After address translation, we call socket in a loop like we did in the client program. Once the socket is created, we configure it. Specifically, we want to ensure that the listening socket's port can be reused after the process that created the socket exits either gracefully or unexpectedly. To do so, we use setSocOpt. It wants an integer for the server socket file descriptor. It wants an integer for level, which is the level of which we want to manipulate the option. More on that later. It wants an integer for option name, which is the name of the option we want to change. It wants a pointer to void for the option value, which is the new value we wish to set the option to. Lastly, it wants a socklen t for the option value length, which is the size of the option value pointed by the previous argument. The function returns integer 0 if it succeeds, or integer -1 if it fails. The first argument is straightforward. Since the option we want to change resides at the socket API level, we set the level to sol socket. The option we are looking to manipulate is so reuse adder. We want to change it to 1, which is enable. However, the fourth argument accepts only a pointer, so we create a quick integer and assign 1 to it. Then we put the newly created integer's address in using the ampersand operator. Lastly, we put in the size of an integer, which is the data type of the previous argument. Once the socket is configured, we must assign it the port to use. To do so, we use the bind function. It wants an integer for the server socket file descriptor. It wants a pointer to a struct socadder that contains the port information. It wants a socklen t for the size of the address length pointed by the previous argument. The function returns integer 0 if it succeeds or integer -1 if it fails. We already have the socket file descriptor returned by the socket function. The latter two arguments are conveniently contained in the struct adder info of the current record. If the binding is successful, we break out of the loop and move on. Otherwise, we close the socket and repeat the loop. Then we write the same exception handling and status message as the client program. Also remember to free the linked list results. To activate the newly created, configured, and bound socket, we use the listen function. It's quite simple. It wants an integer for the server socket file descriptor. It wants an integer for the backlog, which is the maximum number of pending connections that can be in the connection queue before the socket starts to refuse new connections. The function returns integer 0 if it succeeds or integer -1 if it fails. We already have the socket file descriptor. We also have defined a backlog at the beginning of our program. We add another debugging message. To keep the server running indefinitely, we use an infinite loop. Your IDE might complain about this, simply ignore. Within the loop, first a simple debugging message. To accept client connections to the server socket, we use the accept function. It wants an integer for the server socket file descriptor, a pointer to a struct socket adder for the client address, which is the location at which the accept function will store the client socket address information, and a pointer to a socklen t for the size of the struct socket adder pointed by the previous argument. The function returns a non-negative integer file descriptor if it succeeds and integer -1 if it fails. We initialize the data structures needed for the accept function within the while loop. This way, every time the loop is iterated, those values would be reset. We asked the program to attempt to accept the client socket and assign the return value to integer variable client socket. We include some rudimentary exception handling debugging message here. Now we finally have the client socket. We can read from it. To do so, we use the receive function. It is very similar to the send function in a client. It wants an integer for socket, which is the client socket file descriptor from which data are received. It wants a pointer to an array of void type, which is the local buffer's memory address. It wants a size t for length, which specifies the size of the buffer pointed by the previous argument. Lastly, it wants a flag, which we will not use here. The function returns the number of bytes received in type sine size t if it succeeds and -1 if it fails. Importantly, it returns 0 if the peer performs an orderly shutdown. In other words, if a return value of 0 is received, the client has finished sending the file. We declare a buffer here within the loop. Again, every time the loop is iterated, the buffer would be cleaned so that we don't have to do it manually. Then we call the receive function. Again, it's very similar to the send function in a client program. We print the received message out. It is typically the client's responsibility to close the client socket, but we're closing it here just so we don't run into any issues. Lastly, I almost forgot, the function return. Now we're done writing. We save the file and then compile it. As you can see, the compile binary is now on desktop. To show how this works, I'll run it here. On the left side is the server program we just wrote. On the right side is the client program we saw in another video. And voila, message sent and received. Thanks for watching. I'd like to give special thanks to Space Heaters, who did not sponsor this video. If you live in the north and your office is cold AF, you need this. It's like $20 on Amazon. Go get it. This is an Indian Tribe production, all rights very much reserved.